of contemporary art here at the museum. And we'd love to welcome you tonight to the NCMA's Humber Lecture. It's titled Michael Richards, Are You Down? Curators in Conversation. This lecture is supported by the Robert Lee Humber Lecture Endowment. And we are honored to share this exhibition with our community and to host what I know will be an engaging and insightful conversation from our guests here tonight. And to get started, I would like to introduce you all to Dawn Dale. She is the artist Michael Richards' cousin. She is the caretaker of his art and the steward of his estate. I first met Dawn 20 years ago. I was working on an exhibition for the museum that opened in 2003, and it was called Defying Gravity, Contemporary Artists and Flight. And it was at a time when every institution in the state was doing something related to the Wright Brothers' centennial. So it was the 100th anniversary of their first flight at Kitty Hawk, and everyone was celebrating that. And in the summer of 2001, a friend had told me about Michael Richards and his work, and especially the connection of his work to the Tuskegee Airmen. And I thought this will be a perfect fit for this exhibition. And I had a few brief conversations with him, and then September 11th happened, and I thought we will never be able to get his work for the museum. But for 2 years, I looked and worked and searched, and somehow Dawn and I connected. And thanks to her, his phenomenal work, Tar Baby versus Saint Sebastian, came to the museum. It was just a month before the exhibition opened in 2003, and it has been here ever since. So it has been here for 20 years. It is in- It is incredibly beloved by our community and by the people who work here at the museum, and anytime I move it or take it down, even for a day, I hear about it. So we are so grateful to Dawn Dale and to Michael Richards' estate for their incredible partnership with the museum for the past 20 years and for their generosity in letting this work be on view and being shared with the people of North Carolina. So please welcome me and join me in welcoming Dawn Dale to the stage. Thank you.
Good evening. I want to thank everyone for being here. I truly appreciate your presence. I have one thing to clear up before we start. Mike's work was not always in my garage. His father, his work was in storage in Long Island City, and his father was sort of overwhelmed and didn't know what to do with the work. So he gave me the task of handling it. So I took everything from Long Island City and moved it up to a storage facility closer to my home. It was there for about 10 years, just in the storage facility. All I did was pay a storage fee for 10 years. Then one day I got a call and said, Miss Dale, we forget to tell you we had a fire. And the fire was literally in the area where his stuff was stored. So thank goodness there was just smoke on everything, but everything was intact. And the closest and safest place that I found was my home. That's how it ended up in my garage. But I'm glad that it was there because I felt safe. And the other copy of the Tar Baby Saint Sebastian is a life-size statue of Michael, who I felt was taking care of us in my home. Now, I'd like to thank a couple of people. First of all, Shauna, where are you? Thank you. That's the young lady who his exhibition with all his works was first featured in Miami. And they were wonderful. As I said, Linda, it was hilarious. I didn't know how long the work had been here until it just dawned on me last week. My children were 14, 7, and 11 when we came here that first time in 2003, right? Okay, so they were small. Now, my oldest grandchild is the age of my youngest child when we were here 20 years ago. And time just flies. I want to thank Angela. I don't know if Angela's here, but she's the lady who sends me the loan forms every year, faithfully. I remember one year I sent, the year was ending and a new year was beginning. So one year she got two loan forms back. And she's always been so gracious and patient with me. And I'd like to thank Valerie, the director, who I met today, who is an amazing woman who helped, you know, facilitate everything. And last but not least, Alex and Melissa. Alex and Melissa. Melissa I met when she was working at LMCC, and they established an award in Michael's name. She invited me to come for the very first time that the award was given, and that's how I met her. Then I got a phone call one day. She said, do you know where there may be any works that belong to Michael, or do you know anyone who has any? And I basically said, oh, I've got a bunch of boxes in my garage. I said, feel free to come up and look at them. What you see, most of them is what was there. I never opened a box. I never looked at anything. I just knew that this was Michael's life's work, and it just had to be kept safe. That's all. I didn't know where it was going, what was going to happen with it. I just needed to keep it safe. And I am happy to say that you are seeing what I am seeing, and my heart is full. I did right by Michael, and I appreciate everyone for being here. So now, Alex and Melissa are going to come and share with you their work and Michael's work and legacy. Thank you.
I could turn my own mic on. Okay. Okay. Hi. I'm Melissa Levin. I am a co-curator of Michael Richards' Are You Down? I use she, her pronouns, and I'm going to give a brief visual description. I'm a tall, white-skinned woman of Jewish and Eastern European descent. I have dark brown hair with bangs across my forehead. And I'm wearing a peach-colored suit with pants and a blazer.
Hi, everyone. I'm Alex Fialho. I'm also co-curator of Michael Richards' Are You Down? I use he and they pronouns. I'll also do a visual description. I'm a tall, white-skinned, male-presenting person of Portuguese, German, and Swedish descent with short brown hair and blue eyes, wearing a white, blue, and yellow dress shirt, and we are both standing behind a podium.
We're so excited to be here tonight to open the retrospective Michael Richards' Are You Down? We're planning to talk for about 40 minutes to give an overview of Michael Richards' life and art, the retrospective Michael Richards' Are You Down?, and our 7-year legacy stewardship process. We're excited to be sharing here for the first time publicly from our essay from the forthcoming monograph on Michael Richards' art. And we're happy to take a few questions at the end, time permitting. Before we dive into the talk, we want to say a few thank yous. First and foremost, to Don Dale. Visionary, steward and caretaker of Michael Richards' art and our central partner in this work. We want to thank the Museum of Contemporary Art North Miami and director Shauna Sheldon, and everyone on MoCA's team, past and present, for originating the exhibition. We want to thank MCMA, Valerie Hillings, Linda Johnson-Doherty, Blakely Kralovic, Catherine Briggs, and everyone else on the truly amazing MCMA team who has contributed in any way. And we want to thank Eugenie Milroy and AM Conservation, as well as Grayson Cox, for their work since 2016 also to make this exhibition possible.
We also want to thank our partners and co-publishers at CARA, the Center for Art Research and Alliances, including Jane Haight, Anuela Masoko, as well as Shakia Carruthers, the Mellon Foundation for their support of the conservation and study of Michael Richards' body of work, as well as the exhibition lenders, and those who've contributed remembrances. We're also grateful to friends who are here with us today, Alon and Indigo, Dan, Allie, Olivia, and Daniel, as well as family and friends Zooming and YouTubing from online. And finally, deep thanks to Michael's family, friends, community, including his Kingstonian cousin, Maxine, and his friends and fellow artists, William Cordova and Dred Scott, among many others, who contributed immeasurably to our understanding of his life and artistic practice. So before we begin, we'll play a 1 minute intro video of Michael Richards at Art Center South Florida from the late 1990s to start the presentation.
Deals with issues of immigration, assimilation, black culture, and attraction, repulsion to sort of larger society. I've been traveling since I was a child. I grew up in Jamaica in the West Indies. And planes have always been a big part of my life. Pilots in my work function as a symbol of, they're almost images of transcendence. They're these beings that go up into the sky, you know, the offer of freedom, of escape, of, you know, coming to a new land, of, you know, the yellow brick road and success and all of that. But you always come back down to the ground, you know. It's always, you know, maybe I'm Catholic, so maybe it's a little too religious, but it's, you know, always this descent, you know, from the high points back down to the ground, and always a struggle of trying to transcend, to be high again.
Feathers, mirrors, pilots, barbed wire, tar, a chariot, a ladder, airplanes, targets, neon lights.
Arms, hands, heads, hair, helmets, a phallus, nipples, blackface, wings, wings and things.
Icarus, Sisyphus, Tuskegee, sound systems, dance hall, reggae, hip hop, hymns, spirituals.
Saint Sebastian, Jacob, Elijah, the jazz singer, Bert Williams, and Kesey and Condi.
Monuments, monumentality, minimalism, lowriders, a lottery ticket, trophies, winning, losing.
Parliament Funkadelic, Boris Gardner, Brer Rabbit, Rodney King.
Black Beauty sand, resin, bronze, marble dust.
Jamaica, New York, Miami, the Middle Passage, the African diaspora, anti-blackness, blackness.
As Greg Tate, rest in peace and power, foretold in his influential 1986 essay for the Village Voice, Cult Gnats Meet Freaky Deke, quote, though nobody's sent out any announcements yet, the 80s are witnessing the maturation of a post-nationalist black arts movement, one more Afrocentric and cosmopolitan than anything that's come before. The point is that the present generation of black artists is crossbreeding aesthetic references like nobody is even talking about yet, end quote. Integral to a generation of black artists emerging in the 1990s, Michael Richards, who was of Costa Rican and Jamaican lineage, made this vision manifest. Enacting Tate's observations, Richards synthesized vast references in his work, bringing together spirituality and history with popular culture to combine, recast, and reimagine the themes of his practice.
Taped into the pages of Michael Richards' 1997 date book is a newspaper clipping reading, "The trouble with history is that it implies that what happened in the past isn't happening now." As this conveys, Richards knew that the distinction between past and present is as arbitrary as it is manufactured, especially when it comes to power dynamics and systems of oppression. Richards stated, quote, "I think history has always been important to me, because if you examine the past, you can also read the symptoms of what is prevalent now in terms of racial associations and the relationships of power present in our society today. History is interesting in terms of how we mythologize it, how we accept history or interpretations of history as fact, and whose interpretation it is. In many ways, my history is so different from the official white versions," end quote.
Richards was specifically drawn to the Tuskegee Airmen, the first African-American pilots in United States military history, and the complexity of their triumphs in the face of segregation. More generally, flight and aviation were prominent themes for Richards as an exploration of dualities, freedom and escape, ascendance and descent. Other significant influences include cultural, religious, and ritual stories from African, African-American, Jamaican, and Christian traditions, as well as Greek mythology. And, centering his own experience, Richards primarily used his body to cast the figures for his sculptures, which often appear as pilots, saints, or both.
Spanning the decade between 1990 to 2001, Richards created a prolific body of work, including sculpture, drawing, installation, and video. Richards was active in community and in practice throughout the 1990s, a storied time in the New York City art world. He pursued his art making primarily through artist residencies and grants while showing his work in group exhibitions nationally and internationally at the Studio Museum in Harlem, the Bronx Museum, the Miami Art Museum, the Corcoran Gallery of Art, and more. He additionally produced two major outdoor public artworks at Socrates Sculpture Park in Queens, New York, and Franconia Sculpture Park in Schaefer, Minnesota, the latter of which, Are You Down?, the namesake of this retrospective, still stands as a permanent sculpture in Richards' honor.
Along this self-actualizing path, Richards met and showed his work with friends and peers, including artists Shakaya Booker, William Cordova, Renee Cox, Louis Gespert, Lyle Ashton Harris, and Dred Scott, as well as curators Brooke Davis Anderson, Christine Y. Kim, Marisol Nieves, Franklin Sermons, and Jorge Daniel Veneciano. Admired and beloved, many of them have expressed praise for his artistic rigor, gratitude for his friendship, and profound grief at his loss. These include artist William Cordova stating, quote, "I owe much to Michael's friendship, wisdom, and selflessness. Our conversations always involved our family roots in the diaspora. His Jamaican, Costa Rican, and my Peruvian lineage were as layered as our understanding that a label could not be so easily affixed in defining our identities."
Artist Dred Scott shared that, quote, "As much as I will remember Michael as an incredibly brilliant artist and some of his unrealized projects, I really remember him as a friend and the simple things that make up friendship," end quote. And Studio Museum in Harlem director Thelma Golden reflected that, quote, "Michael Richards' work was profound and powerful, mining Black culture and American history to create beautiful, poetic objects that engage with the often tremendous contradictions between dominant historical narratives and African-American experiences," end quote.
Tragically, Michael Richards passed away on September 11th, 2001, while working in his Lower Manhattan Cultural Council Worldview Studio on the 92nd floor of World Trade Center Tower 1. At age 38, Richards was an emerging artist whose incisive aesthetic held immense promise to make him a leading figure in contemporary art. Richards' cousin, Don Dale, has stored and cared for the majority of his artworks for over two decades following his passing. In the 15 years between 2001 and 2016, Richard's work fell largely out of public view, remaining mostly in unopened boxes.
Just got chills. The first time we ever saw Michael Richard's art was in Don's garage. As curators, our engagement with Richard's work began in earnest in 2016, in the context of conceiving and curating the exhibition Michael Richard's Winged at Lower Manhattan Cultural Council. What began initially as an exhibition has transformed into a years-long collaborative and caretaking project around Richard's art life and legacy. In this time, we have worked closely with Don and a wide range of interlocutors in the ongoing stewardship of Richard's art. We actively acknowledge that we are two white curators stewarding the legacy of a Black artist. We have developed an ethos and approach to this work that first and foremost centers Richard's voice. We are also in consistent dialogue with Richard's contemporaries, artists, curators, and friends, whose diverse perspectives we closely engage in our community-based research process.
In its resurfacing since 2016, through these extensive conversations with Richard's community, recent press and scholarship, research-intensive exhibitions, including this retrospective, Michael Richard's Are You Down?, and a forthcoming monograph publication, much has been revealed. Yet, with limited and primarily analog texts and documentation in widely dispersed personal and institutional archives, significant aspects of Richard's artwork and archives still remain unknown to us. However increasingly available the story of his life's work may be through caretaking, stewardship, scholarship, and recollection.
In this regard, at the 2019 symposium at Stanford University, Flight, Diaspora, Identity, and Afterlife, a symposium on the art of Michael Richard's, scholar Jakia Carruthers has thoughtfully synthesized the stakes of our curatorial and legacy stewardship practice in stating, quote, "Thinking on the fragmented archive of an artist whose impact is often overshadowed by the spectacular terms of his death, we mark Michael Richard's work present and possible, a living articulation of the past, future thought, a past too easily reduced to being belated, final, or unalive, a mistake we remedy through our ongoing relation to these works and their critical meaning," end quote.
Inextricably connected to the moment of its making in the 1990s, Richard's artistic engagement with Blackness, flight, diaspora, spirituality, police brutality, and monuments undeniably also contains a deep and knowing personal and cultural prescience, and his body of work remains timely and resonant decades after its creation. In our curatorial and legacy stewardship work, we share our research and insights in the hopes of emphatically encouraging continued and expansive study in order to create the fullest and most nuanced understanding of this extraordinary person and artist. At every turn, we have been prompted, guided, and called to keep readings of Richard's work complex.
With this in mind, we aim to offer audiences, quoting Richard's artist statement, an entry into the work, and end quote, guiding the viewer through the development of Richard's creative practice during his prolific decade of artistic production between 1990 and 2001. We center Richard's own perspective in curatorial texts and exhibition wall labels through extensive excerpts from interviews and artist statements in concert with related scholarship, while also describing and contextualizing the histories and socio-political dynamics he engaged in his art. Indeed, for an artist whose story is often told from the perspective of his passing, we wish to center for the viewer the story of Richard's life.
Michael Richard's was born in Brooklyn, New York in 1963 and raised in Kingston, Jamaica. His mother, Mary, was Costa Rican, born in Limon, and his father, Fred, was Jamaican, born in the St. Catherine Parish. Very much a child of the Caribbean diaspora, Richard's came of age in post-independence Jamaica and post-civil rights era United States. He grew up and went to primary school and high school in Kingston, while traveling regularly back and forth to New York with his family. In a late 1990s interview from his Miami Beach studio, Richard's reflected on the prevalent theme of flight in his work, saying, quote, I've been traveling since I was a child. I grew up in Jamaica in the West Indies, and planes have always been a big part of my life." End quote.
Richards returned to New York for university, earning a BA at Queens College in 1985 and a master's in fine arts at New York University in 1991. After school, Richards intentionally sought out, applied for, and subsequently received and participated in a number of pivotal grants, fellowships, and artist residencies, including the Whitney Independent Study Program from 1992 to 93, the Artists in the Marketplace Fellowship at the Bronx Museum of the Arts in 1994, the Studio Museum in Harlem's Artist in Residence Program from 1995 to 96, and Art Center South Florida's Studio Program, now Oolite Arts, from 1997 to 2000. Outside of, but adjacent to, the confines of an exclusive and predominantly white commercial art world, these programs were artist-centered, mission-driven, and responsive to changing conditions over time. Offering physical and intellectual spaces, as well as resources and opportunities for artists. In these community-minded places of artistic and professional development, Richards was experimental and productive. Simultaneously, he exhibited his work nationally and internationally.
It is especially significant to display Richards' retrospective at the North Carolina Museum of Art. Seen here are printed materials and documentation from the museum's 2003 exhibition, Defying Gravity, Contemporary Art and Flight, which marked the centennial of the Wright brothers' first flight in North Carolina. Defying Gravity included Richards' work and initiated the relationship between Richards and the NCMA. Curator Linda Doherty's conversations with the artist started before he passed, and the exhibition opened 2 years later in 2003. Richards' sculpture, Tar Baby versus St. Sebastian, has been on long-term loan ever since, and as of this year, has been on continuous view at the NCMA for over two decades. At the same time, displaying the retrospective at NCMA is an opportunity to expand the discussion of Michael Richards' work, including and beyond Tar Baby versus St. Sebastian, displaying the full breadth of Richards' wide-ranging artistic practice.
The years 1990 to 93 were a formative period of conceptual, formal, and community development for Richards. Starting in 1990, while still pursuing a master's degree at New York University, Richards began to lay the groundwork for his artistic practice and visual vocabulary that would evolve over the following decade. As observed by Christine Y. Kim and Franklin Sermons in 2001, quote, "Michael Richards' work is a synthesis of the 1990s Black arts movement in which he grew up, and the multiculturalism prevalent in his formative years as a student and artist," end quote.
During this time, Richards created room-sized, site-based installations that were both deeply personal and profoundly political. These early installations contended directly with the histories and ongoing consequences of anti-Blackness, made manifest through slavery and its afterlives, such as History, Meditating on the Middle Passage, which, as Richards described, quote, "consists of three life-size boats evoking ship convoys used in the Middle Passage," end quote. As well as the racial violence of blackface minstrel performance, as seen in Let Me Entertain You, an installation that Richards wrote, quote, "evokes a historical dressing room of the famous performer Burt Williams," end quote. These artworks were displayed in situ, and while most of the elements comprising them appear to no longer exist, installation images in the form of 35 millimeter slides and brief accompanying image descriptions written by Richards at the time, all of which are included in the exhibition, show the formation of his artistic vision.
As both context and backdrop, the 1990s in New York City was a time of fervent dialogue around multiculturalism and identity politics, exemplified by three influential exhibitions: The Decade Show, Frameworks of Identity in the 1980s, a multi-institution collaboration between the New Museum, the Studio Museum in Harlem, and the Museum of Contemporary Hispanic Art in 1990. The 1993 Biennial Exhibition, curated by Elizabeth Sussman with Thelma Golden, John G. Hanhart, and Lisa Phillips at the Whitney Museum of American Art in 1993, and Black Male, Representations of Masculinity in Contemporary American Art, also at the Whitney, and curated by Thelma Golden in 1994. Countering the conservative art world and national status quo, These exhibitions place identity formation and cultural diversity at the heart of their curatorial framework, displaying formally experimental artworks that predominantly addressed issues of race, gender, and sexuality. While Richard's early artworks were not included in the decade show, The 93 Biennial or Black Male, it is very likely that he would have seen these exhibitions. The thinking behind them and the artists and works included, as well as the wide-ranging critical responses, provide significant insight into this early moment in Richard's emerging artistic practice.
By the mid-1990s, Richard's practice began to shift, a transition he acknowledged by saying, quote, "Until recently, I've primarily made installations, and now I'm doing smaller sculptural objects while focusing more on an internal debate," end quote. As his work developed, Richards distilled the expansive scale of installation works into autonomous sculptures that still exhibited capacious meaning. For example, in A Loss of Faith Brings Vertigo from 1994, Richards directly addressed contemporary political contexts, specifically racially motivated police brutality against Rodney King, the subsequent uprisings in Los Angeles, and the frenzied and incessant media coverage. In this work, the four outermost bust-like heads cast from Richard's own bear photo-transferred images of officers in confrontational postures with plaques underneath adhered to the pedestals reading, "When I was young, I wanted to be a policeman." This phrase takes on additional meaning in light of the fact that Richards grew up across the street from a police station in Kingston, which we recently learned on a research trip to his hometown.
The fifth and central disembodied head displays an image of King's bruised and swollen face on the forehead and slowly rotates, creating an effect of disorientation. The plaque on this pedestal bears the titular phrase, "A loss of faith brings vertigo." With King at the center, the narrative of Richard's sculpture is one of a loss of faith in the police and the disillusion of their implicit relationship to safety and protection. In the face of continued murders of Black people at the hands of police, and the responsive Black Lives Matter movement, this work continues to have urgent and pressing resonance over a quarter century after its creation. In this period, Richards also deepened his exploration of kinetic and sonic elements, such as motors, lights, and music in his sculptures, such as Swing Low. Richard's souped-up chariot is outfitted like a lowrider car with blue neon underglow and a speaker system that blasts 1990s-era Jamaican reggae, dub, and dancehall music. The work's title references lowrider car culture, as well as the spiritual Swing Low, Sweet Chariot, pointing to redemption and ascent to heaven or home. An uncommon and even transgressive encounter in the museum space, viewers can hear Swing Low booming before they see it.
Richards was also an avid draftsman, an aspect of his work that has been lesser known than his sculptural practice. As with all of his work, Richard's drawings explore the complexity of recasting language, objects, and the body. Specifically, anatomized body parts are present throughout his drawing practice, with skin, eyes, mouths, and hair as sites of intervention. In multiple works on paper, Richards includes rubber molds of his own teeth and nipples. Richard's drawings speak in tones both subversive and melancholic. In addition to individual drawings from 1996 to 2000, Richard steadily generated his Escape Plan series. These drawings pair intricately rendered images with poetic and acerbic texts that describe thwarted plans for escape and speak to the transcendent potential of objects as well as their contradictory weight, often invoking racial stereotypes and the prejudices they reinforce.
Richard stated, quote, "In a lot of my work, the metaphor of escape is a recurring one. It's about a societal escape, trying to transcend the societal boundaries that we set up as an invisible trap around us," end quote. Here we see Escape Plan 9, I believe, showing a detail of a wrought iron gate and reading, "Always told of his invisibility, he took comfort in the fact that he could escape by simply walking through the front gate." Escape Plan 12 features an outline of a hand, likely Richard's own, filled in with celestial imagery of the dark night sky. He dreamed that if he reached for the stars, his arms would grow and lift him out of captivity. But those who saw him thought he was merely surrendering. Escape Plan 100 is simply a lottery ticket, lightly shaded in signature yellow and red, without additional text.
Flight and aviation had become the central themes of Richard's practice by the mid-1990s. His artworks from this period took the form of airplanes and surreal winged appendages, both suspended and grounded, with the Greek myth of Icarus and its attendant implications alluded to in multiple drawings and sculptures. Starting in 1996, Richards also began to engage the legacy of the Tuskegee Airmen, the evolution of which would continue into the early 2000s. Throughout these works, Richards displayed a reverence for flight and the duality of flight's possibilities for ascendance and descent, as well as its capacity for contradiction and metaphor. In flight-related artworks from this prolific moment, Richards consistently returned to hair as an artistic medium through which to interrogate societal expectations, deeply ingrained prejudices, and pervasive stereotypes. Indeed, Richards made the connection between flight and hair in his practice explicit in his personal email address at the time, seen here on this business card from the late 1990s. And the email address is blackairsalon@aol.com. As Perez Art Museum Miami director and monograph contributor Franklin Sermons, who was Richard's good friend, noted, quote, his business card with a New York phone number and a Miami phone number made it clear. If you didn't know how much he was loved in the city that you were less familiar with, he had a whole life in both, end quote.
Richards further elaborated on his use of materials, noting, quote, many of the materials I use, such as hair, castings from my body, resins, bronze, and plastic, are references to my body. Mainly, it's talking about my own ambiguity in terms of certain racial and social boundaries. I use hair and skin in an investigative way to raise questions of duality about race and social issues, end quote. In this soaring sculpture, Airfall One, his eyes on the sparrow, and I know he's watching me, from 1997, 50 small airplanes wrapped in synthetic hair spiral downwards from a cloud of hair toward a mirrored target on the floor, which reflects their flight back upward. The work's title quotes a religious hymn about faith in the face of hardship and God's care for all beings, including creatures as small as sparrows.
In another work from this period, The Great Black Airman Tuskegee from 1996, a nude, headless, winged torso lies supine as a fallen monument. As Richards stated, quote, this work is in the form of a public monument. You see bronze monuments in the park and walk past them, yet they're supposed to be the highest honor in our society. With this installation, it gets ambiguous because Tuskegee is inscribed on the base. People assume it's referring to the Tuskegee Airmen, but it's also about the Tuskegee experiments. At the same time and place where the Tuskegee Airmen were training, black men were being used in experiments to see how syphilis would progress through their bodies. Therefore, it's a destroyed and neglected monument and a sexualized and allegorical work, end quote.
While the body, often his own body, featured prominently starting with Richard's earliest artworks, it appeared fragmented for many years as dismembered heads, arms, and feet. As Richard's dexterity and confidence as a sculptor grew, so too did the size of the sculptural figures that he created. In a sense, over time, Richard's practice moves towards embodiment. Simultaneously, he also deepened his engagement with the Tuskegee Airmen, the central touchstone in his artwork throughout the second half of the 1990s. All of his full figure sculptures are created in their image. Richards expressed his relationship to their legacy, stating, quote, the Tuskegee Airmen are a perfect metaphor because they were considered race men and were working to overturn all the myths and uplift the race. You would work twice as hard and be an example to your race. They were getting into those planes and flying twice as many missions as white pilots, because they were standard bearers of their race. They had to be brave, no matter how heavily outgunned they were. It's also interesting in terms of the interior psychological dialogue that must have been going on with them, especially the fact that once they landed the planes and walked out, they could not eat in the same mess quarters as white officers. They had segregated barracks. Yet they were fighting for the ideas of freedom, justice, and the American way. It's a very complicated metaphor. It has a lot to do with my own questions about my place within society, working within society, making art, and basically making the culture of the society," end quote.
Richards created Free Fall, his first life-size figurative sculpture, in New York during a fellowship with Socrates Sculpture Park in 1997. In its original configuration, the Tuskegee Airmen figure stood atop a tiny landing over 10 feet high with a bucket below. Notably, the figure, now in the Brooklyn Museum's collection, is riddled with nails, alluding to Congolese Nkisi and Kondi power figures, global indigenous ritual traditions, and the Christian stigmata. Similarly, for Tar Baby versus Saint Sebastian, Richards cast his body in resin and outfitted the figure as a Tuskegee Airman. However, in this work, the torso is pierced with miniature airplanes and painted a golden bronze. Life-size and levitating, amidst bombardment, the figure appears both peaceful and pained. The work's title conflates and confronts two well-known narratives, an African and African-American folktale in which the character Br'er Fox makes a doll known as Tar Baby to ensnare his rival Br'er Rabbit, and the iconic Saint Sebastian, an early Christian martyr from the 3rd century who is represented throughout art history. This sculpture exemplifies how Richards synthesized and complicated a range of references throughout his work.
Richards created two versions of Tar Baby versus Saint Sebastian. One has been on display at NCMA since its inclusion in the 2003 exhibition, Defying Gravity. The second version, which is on view in the retrospective, was in storage between 2001 and 2016, when it underwent significant restoration. And here you can see us during the installation period, putting the NCMA version that's been on long-term loan next to the version that's been in the estate's collection. And the comparison, you see the boots on one are a little bit larger, the patina color is a little different, and the NCMA version has few extra planes. The last artwork we will discuss, this installation at NCMA marks the first time both versions have been exhibited simultaneously in the same museum. The last artwork we will discuss is Are You Down?, the namesake of the exhibition. Consisting of three identical down pilots cast from the artist's body, Are You Down? Is a complex homage to the Tuskegee Airmen. These heroes are rendered on the ground, and one has to look down or get down to engage them. In contrast to the majority of monuments, which are typically triumphant statues of white men raised on pedestals. In an outdoor version of the sculpture, the pilots surround a black and white target and are set in shimmering black sand. Richards originally created Are You Down? In 1999, and the sculpture was then shown at the Corcoran Gallery of Art. In 2000, Richards realized the previously mentioned outdoor version of the installation at Franconia Sculpture Park, which now stands as the park's only permanent sculpture.
Richards' agility with language and metaphor is particularly evident in his titles, with meanings that iterate and unfold. In its most colloquial reading, Are You Down? Is a general inquiry, simply meaning, are you into this? In a more literal reading, Are You Down? May refer directly to the fact that these pilots are in fact downed, grounded, literally, emotionally, or are you down as in how far are you willing to go? As author and monograph contributor Edwige Danticat has also noted, Are You Down? Could also have been what the aviators asked each other from their airplanes. A seemingly straightforward enough phrase in Richard's hands, read alongside the sculpture, the inquiry, Are You Down? Takes on abundant connotations. Ultimately, the title pointedly asks the viewer, are you down?
As many have acknowledged, in light of the devastating circumstances of Richard's passing, the afterlife of his artworks, especially those including airplanes, wings, and pilots, take on an added prescience. The connections are astonishing, uncanny, painful, and powerful. From the planes piercing the figure's torso in Tar Baby versus Saint Sebastian, to a group of works called Escape Plans, to titles like Airfall 1, Free Fall, and Are You Down?
Though this afterlife plays a deeply meaningful part in Richard's story, other readings, like those offered here, start from engaging the wide-ranging imagery and metaphoric possibilities of Richard's art, both on his own terms and with our benefit of hindsight. In the context of Richard's own words and the socio-political climate of his lifetime, we can read the continued relevance, the politics, and the poetics of his Prussian artworks today. And as Richard's cousin, Don Dale, has poignantly expressed, quote, he wanted to say something to the world, but he's still saying it. His work is saying it for him, end quote.
Richard's practice is noteworthy for the ways in which it offers an artistic vision that unfolds multivalently. While Richard's references are incredibly expansive, the ideas, motifs, and materiality of his work iterate and speak to each other across the decade of his artistic production. As William Cordova has stated, quote, his body of work is basically one project evolving slowly, end quote. We would add that it is in fact still evolving. Richard's turned history on its head, combining, remixing, and reimagining a wide range of historical and contemporary references in his art. In the process of considering the robust breadth of Richard's work, we have aimed to animate the histories in and of his artistic practice.
And while Richard's art is certainly of its time, formed in the context of the multiculturalism and identity politics of the 1990s, simultaneously, the resurfacing of his works that interrogate systems and cycles of oppression, racism, white supremacy, and anti-blackness, and their impacts on lived experience in mind and body, speak powerfully to our contemporary times. Highlighting Richard's engagement with history, its erasures, and its repetitions is especially significant, given that in the intervening years between 2001 and 2016, Richard's body of work itself was perhaps at risk of being lost to history. Richard's work elicits an abundant range of responses, from the visceral to the scholarly, including meditation, confrontation, winks and nods, reflection, and analysis. Indeed, there is always more to see, more to say, more that is waiting to be written. It is our hope that this exhibition inspires continued conversations, scholarship, and engagement around Michael Richard's art, life, and legacy. Thank you.
Thank you. I think we are open to taking a couple of questions from the audience, if there are any. Yes. We're going to bring a microphone.
So disclaimer, I am a death and dirt attorney, meaning that I do help people plan for what happens to their assets. So Don, I just want to thank you for stewarding his work. I can't imagine what that must have felt like for you, but I do appreciate the volume of what you've done. So given that, you know, just tying into how you ended your speech, I am curious, what is the succession plan, if you will, for stewarding his work going forward? And another bias, you know, looking at Jean-Michel Basquiat and how his work has really been commodified, my hope is that that's not gonna happen to Mr. Richard's work. So if you could share, Don could share, what is the plan?
Thank you for that question.
You want me to start? Okay. Thank you for that question. That's a big question in any world, but in the art world, obviously, in particular. We have obviously been just taking an extremely slow, thoughtful, Michael Richard-centered approach to showing and sharing the work. And so our plan has evolved organically. I don't even know, I mean, we might not even call it a plan per se, except to say that our goals are to share the work with the world and to keep it safe. We're very lucky to have received a grant from the Mellon Foundation to work on the conservation and study of the work. And so I would say that our thinking is still evolving, not to be too evasive, but you know, we are so honored to be able to share the work through retrospective exhibitions, through MoCA, through NCMA. We're making a monograph with co-publishers Mocha and Cara. And so we're kind of, you know, each project, each aspect of the project, we kind of like see where that's gonna take us next. And we are also thinking long-term, but I think it's thinking that's still evolving.
And I think I'll just add briefly that that thinking is also initiated in a close conversation with Dawn, and the bringing the work back to the fore, showing it through exhibitions and highlighting it in contextual and scholarly conversations has been really the focus of recent years. And now that it feels like it is in an art world dialogue and discourse, it feels exciting to think about what's possible in terms of next steps for where the work will go. So, yeah, thank you.
Hi, you two. My question, knowing that both of you, outside of the work that you've done with Dawn to help steward Michael's legacy, is supporting contemporary artists in the work that they do. You know, both of you are doing that in your work in the arts and in scholarship. So my question is, I wanna, as I was going through the gallery, I was prompted to think about all of these, a number of Black contemporary artists looking at things like the cast bus, made me think of Titus Kaphor, for example. So my question is for you all to dream in the spirit of keeping this work live with, if you could see one of the works in Are You Down alongside another work of a contemporary artist with whom you feel like Michael is still in conversation with today, maybe just to dream with us about who those artists would be. And what kind of conversations, right, you would hope to see his works with alongside the kind of contemporary arts conversations y'all are in.
Yeah, thank you. I might take a second. Thank you for the question. We've long dreamed of what it would mean to do a group exhibition with Michael Richards' practice in dialogue with those he was in dialogue with during his lifetime, artists like Dred Scott, William Cordova, Shakaya Booker, the list goes on and on. And so that feels like Luis Gispert. We could, yeah, there's very many brilliant and thoughtful artists who've had decades-long careers since their friendship with Michael who were inspired by and in close community and conversation with him. So that would be a great group exhibition in our ideas. And that I think would be kind of a place to start with Michael in that context and in community. And then I'd love the idea of contemporary artists, kind of an intergenerational conversation that would also be a really inspiring possibility.
I'll just add that there actually is an exhibition up right now on the artist Juan Francisco Elso at El Museo del Barrio. And Michael's work is included in that show. And it's because it's also a body of work that whose legacy was tended to by multiple people, including the curators Olga Viso and Susanna Temkin. And so while there's a relatively modest body of work, they also, they're able to show incredibly, they also created a group show around that. And they've included Michael's work both in the exhibition and in the book that's accompanying it. And that group show includes, I'm not gonna remember most people, but I'm just remembering like Lorraine O'Grady and also a new commission from Tiana Nekia McLaudin. And it's really, it definitely has been a vision. It feels just like this amazing opportunity to see Michael's work in this group context. And it's something that we really wanna see. So that show is really exciting. It's also going to Mocha North Miami. Can I say that? Okay, sorry. So there's a lot of synergy there anyway, so.
In your compiling of the monograph and also your time research, were there any new discoveries or anything that you found of note personally in regards to the artist's background, the artist's practices, or his philosophy that you thought you would like to share or something that you're very excited about?
Yeah, I mean, I think the whole process has been a revelation at various turns. And I think we, as Dawn said, Melissa and I called and said, started this process and said, how do we begin to learn more about Michael's practice? And from there, we've had over 100 conversations in the 7 years that we've been working through this project, over 100 conversations with people who knew Michael in his lifetime. So they've revealed so much about his practice, his commitment, his generosity, his smile, So thinking about Michael as a person has really been central to our curatorial project too. And so that has been really important. And then also, of course, learning more and more about the work. Even in NCMA, there's a video work that's on display for the first time that Dawn found a tape in her home that we've recently had digitized. So, you know, the Bronx Museum just found slides of an early installation. So it continues more and more as the work gets shown, more comes back about his practice.
And yeah, I mean, I think we try to share almost everything, you know, that it's, we are very open about our process. We're very iterative. Learning from friends and family about, you know, his life, his art making. There's a section in the show called Remembrances and Ephemera. There's 18 remembrances from curators and colleagues and friends. There's, you know, vitrines full of materials that include beautiful photographs of Michael, both in exhibitions, but also in the studio making the work. So I think actually we do have an ethos of sharing everything we can about Michael and his practice, and also about our process in kind of even exhibition making and our work with Dawn. So
I'm conscious of time, but are we two more
two
questions?
More. Okay.
Okay.
Congratulations on another beautiful show. I'm curious about the iteration process and looking back on that early LMCC show. So just what is it like to go from that moment, a very early moment, to now? Just curious about that process.
Yeah, thank you for that question. It has been a journey, something we say a lot. You know, the LMCC show was itself, I don't know, we were just like, we were so in a process while we were kind of figuring out what, you know, going all simultaneously, going to Dawn's garage, visiting archives, talking with people that knew Michael, just taking in as much information as we possibly could. And in some senses, I just feel like, how did the show, you know, the show manifested? And all, and we had, you know, 8 sculptures that we work with this amazing conservation team in over the course of 6 months. And so that ultimately was a really short span of time to initiate a project that's now 7+ years and ongoing. And so I think it's been, and like Alex just said, we're constantly learning, absorbing, you know, hearing new stories. And so I think it's just been an evolution, and unfolding is something that we say a lot, just to also even think about Dawn's garage and the process of, you know, when we did the LMCC show, kind of taking half the work out of the garage and then seeing the garage slowly get emptier and the galleries get more filled. Has been a really beautiful process.
Yeah, I'll just add, we often say it's the project of a lifetime, in the sense of Michael's lifetime, thinking about his work. It's also, we have grown alongside each other in these 7 years, doing this work as independent curators, alongside nonprofit work, school. So it's our side, part-time, full-time process, project, you know, and so, we've grown alongside each other in that work. When we first visited Dawn, as she noted, her granddaughter was, you know, is now older, but was young when we visited, a little baby, you know, and so now, it's been a really beautiful process in that sense. And we just learned so much more about the work. We got an email this morning from a North Carolina-based artist who had a studio alongside Michael Richards, I think it's okay to share, to say this.
Yeah,
in LMCC, and had done sketches days after 9/11 of where people's studios were and what works he was making that were in the studio. In addition to the piece that's in the show, there was a ladder made of tongues. We've never heard of that. That was this morning because of the NCMA announcement of the public program. So more and more keeps unfolding, and it's been a really beautiful process to see it from that 2016 LMCC show to now. And I'll just note, It's been really incredible that each of the contexts has felt really meaningful to bring Michael's work back to communities that have really engaged it. So the LMCC show was the first time Tar Baby for St. Sebastian, and a lot of the work had been seen in 15 years in New York City. The MoCA Miami retrospective, which really expanded the show, allowed us to show the full breadth of Michael's practice. Michael had his largest slash only solo exhibition in his lifetime in a gallery literally across the street from MoCA North Miami. So he had walked on 125th in North Miami in his lifetime, and then we showed the retrospective across the street to bring the work here where Tar Baby for St. Sebastian has been on view for 20 years. So these contexts have felt really important to Michael's practice, and so to bring the full retrospective to each of these has been really incredible. There was one more.
All right, my question's pretty basic.
Yeah.
I just want to understand Michael a little bit more.
Please.
And his fascination with flying. Did Michael fly? Did he want to fly? Did he meet a Tuskegee Airman himself? I would like to know basically how that became such a passion of his.
It's a great question. I'm not sure we can fully answer it, to be honest, which is also part of the work and the process. You know, we quoted him from childhood saying that planes were a big part of his life, growing up between Jamaica and New York. And so, you know, he clearly had a reverence for flight as, I think, both something that was part of almost a daily life, but also something that obviously was a fascination. But, you know, I don't know. I don't know if anyone else in here knows if he met a Tuskegee Airman or...
Yeah, Wendell Walker, his friend, is in the audience.
A combination of all those things. And, you know, the dreams that I don't think we had flight dreams in here, but they can be really wonderful. You're flying, but you've got to land, and that frightening part of that. So we used to talk about that a lot.
Really? Because he embodies it. So yeah. It seems very central to who he was.
I think it's also interesting that flight is, there's a spectrum, right, of feathers, wings, to airplanes and pilots. And so it's kind of, there's an iteration there as well.
It's Icarus, it's the Tuskegee Airmen, it's Greek mythology, it's pilots. So it's flight from many angles, and both the possibilities of flight and the perils of flight. So, really grateful for this audience. We'll take it out with a little outro from Swing Low.
Thank you all so much, online, in person.
One thing, see if you understand. Come and say some of them ask me where me get it from. Just some of them ask me where me get it from. I told them, no, it's from creation. I told them, no, it's from creation. Bam, bam, bam.